This is, yeah, well, as was already said, this is joint work, and fairly recent joint work back from August and July this year, still in the process of getting written up. It's, in a way, I wouldn't, it's really new work in the sense that I wouldn't be surprised if there is things to simplify, there are things to improve, but I think there is also, it also simplifies a bunch of old work. So what is this about? On the most basic level, this is about post-its. So I have the slide only to make sure that we're all using the same notation. Post-its will be drawn as HASA diagrams. So this is 1-1, is under 1-2, and so on. And we're going to use this notation covered by and covers. An element U is covered by an element V if U is under V, and there is nothing between them. And similarly, covered by is just the opposite relation. Okay, here is another piece of simple notation. If I have a finite post-it P, I let P hat denote the post-it I obtained from P by adding a... Oops, there was somebody I think has echo. Okay, so I get P hat from P by adding in a new global minimum element and a new global maximum element. And I call them 0 and 1, even if P itself already has a global maximum like this delta. Okay, linear extensions, I'm pretty sure you all know. This is again a matter of getting notations consistent. For me, a linear extension of a post-it P means a list of all its elements, each only once, such that a bigger element can never appear before a smaller element. So for example, this post-it has two linear extensions. You can start with alpha beta or you can start with beta alpha. An order ideal is a subset of our post-it that is closed downwards. So if I have an element in the order ideal, then everything below this element must also be in the order ideal. So here are some examples of order ideals where the order ideal is drawn in red and the rest in black. And we let J of P denote the set of all order ideals. So the set of order ideals is the ground set for a pretty interesting map, a permutation of the set, which is nowadays known as classical row motion. It has been discovered many times, long before anybody called it row motion. I think the name is barely 10 years old, but it has been discovered by several people in several contexts. In particular, in the context of Lie theory, which is in a way, we will see Lie theory in the background every once in a while in this talk. One fairly interesting question is how to actually explain this phenomena using Lie theory, because they're definitely related. So what is classical row motion? You have a finite post-it P and its set of order ideals. And you take the following map from the set to itself. You're given an order ideal S. You transform it into a new order ideal R of S. That's defined as follows. So here is a running example. Here is a post-it, and in those black balls are the order ideal. Now we apply the following three-step procedure. Sorry, but I have to erase the drawings. We apply the following three-step procedure. First, we invert the colors. Okay, somebody has echo again. We invert the colors, so we take the complement of the order ideal. Then we boil it down to the generators, so we take only the set of minimal elements of this complement. So the two blue things on the top disappear because they are not minimal, they are above those. And finally, we complete downwards. So we make this into an order ideal again by adding whatever is under it. And this is R of S. So once again, start with an order ideal, take its complement, take its minimals, and complete it downwards to get an order ideal again. It's not hard to see that this is actually a permutation of G of P, so it's invertible. And as a permutation of a finite set, it has finite order. But of course, the order can be pretty large. However, it has turned out that for some types of calls at P, the order can be computed explicitly. And here is, I think, the nicest example, which is when P is a rectangle, or in other words, a product of two totally ordered chains. In this case, the order of this map of classical row motion is simply P plus Q. P is the number of elements in one chain and Q is the number of elements in the other. So this would be 5 in this case. This is in a paper by Stryker and Williams 10 years ago. I think it's older. I forgot who actually found it. So here is an example. You start with this order ideal. After one row motion becomes this. After two row motions, it's this. After three, it's this. After four, it's this. And after 5, it's back where you started. And these rectangles are not the only posts with such nice behavior. Another class is triangles like that looks like this. I call them delta shaped. And here, the order is 2p, where p is, in this case, it's, I think, not the number of vertices here, but the number of vertices plus 1. Either way, there is something else going on here. That if you apply this map p times, you don't get back where you started, but you get back to the reflection in the y-axis, so in the vertical axis. I find this somewhat surprising because you wouldn't expect it to reflect. The map isn't defined in a way that connects to the symmetry somehow. How does this row motion know that there is a symmetry axis? Well, somehow if you do it p times, it learns about it. So more examples come from Lie theory in different ways. This is still a topic of ongoing study. But for us, classical row motion is first and foremost a motivation. We are going to generalize it so many times, you will barely recognize it. But before I go on, there is yet another definition of classical row motion that gives the same map, but is maybe a little bit, I mean, it views it from a different perspective. If I have a post at P and an element V, there is something called a V toggle. This is also a permutation of J of P, but it's unlike classical row motion, it's much simpler. All it does is it adds V if it's possible, it removes V if it's possible, otherwise it does nothing. And by it's possible, I mean that the result is still an order ideal. I have to get an order ideal. So I can only add V if there is nothing else below V that isn't already in the order ideal. And similarly for subtracting. And turns out that, well, these toggles are much simpler than row motion. Row motion is actually the composition of these toggles in a certain order. And what order? You just have to find the linear extension of P. And then you compose those toggles from top to bottom according to this extension. So you can view a row motion as a composition of the toggles. So in this talk, I'm going to talk not about classical row motion, but about non-commutative birational row motion. A generalization of it with the ideas going back to several people, David Einstein, Jim Probe, Tom Robey, Anatoly Kirillov, Arkady Berenstein, and then discuss in detail what happens to the order P plus Q phenomenon in rectangles. These are the only posits for which we have really done anything like proper study of this generality. A lot of work in progress. So we'll have a ring K. A K labeling of a post at P will mean a function from P hat to K. So we assign to every element of our post a label, but we also assign labels to the elements, to the new global minimum 0 and the new global maximum 1, which is why we're having P hat. Yes, so the values of this function will be called the labels, and we draw it just by putting each label in the place where the corresponding element is in the Hasse diagram. So this is a labeling of a 2x2 rectangle by rational numbers. Okay, and now instead of generalizing the original definition of classical row motion, we generalize the toggle definition. So let's first generalize the toggle. It is a partial map that takes a K labeling and gives another K labeling. So don't be afraid. This formula is not as bad as it sounds. First of all, I'm going to use the abbreviation M bar for the inverse of an element M in the ring. It's just more convenient. You don't want parentheses everywhere here. Next, the toggle is again a very local map. When I toggle at the vertex V, the only label that changes is the label at V. All the other labels stay the same. So how does the label at V change? The label at V, first of all, it gets inverted. This is this F of V bar here. Secondly, on the left, I multiply with the sum of the labels at all elements that are just below V. And by just below, I mean covered by. So for a rectangle, for example, there is usually just two labels. Here is V. Here are the two labels. Here are the two elements that are just below V. And on the top, you have two elements that are just above V. Sometimes you have less than two when V is on the boundary. So you take those two elements, you take their sum, and you multiply it on the left. On the right, you make something slightly more complicated. You take the elements just above, and you take their harmonic sum. So as a reminder, what is the harmonic sum of two numbers? Let me call it hashtag. A hashtag B is the inverse of the sum of their inverses. So I take the harmonic sum and I multiply it on the right. And this is, by the way, why we had to define p hat. Because if we hadn't defined p hat, sometimes this sum would be empty and then we would be dividing by zero. Sometimes this sum would be empty and then we would be multiplying by zero, which is just as bad because you want it to be invertible for the next time. So this is important to have always something below and something above. Okay, what next? So this is a map. You know, it looks a lot like certain things in cluster algebras or SOBOS. The numbers that, well, elements of the ring that are getting inverted can fail to be invertible. I'm going to pretend that it's defined most of the time, because, for example, when K is a field, an infinite field, this is defined almost everywhere. It's a rational map that's dominant. So when K is a ring, well, you can pretend that it's we basically only care about the cases where this is defined. If something here is undefined, well, you have to leave it undefined then. As I said, this is a local change. Only the label at V gets changed. If K is commutative, then if you do this toggle twice, you get back the original map. I mean, unless you had a division by zero problem. If K is not commutative, this does not actually take you back. It's not an involution anymore. It gives you some sort of twist when you do it twice. But still, you can use those toggles. You just, the word toggle is maybe a little bit misplaced. And how do we, now we can define non-commutative birational row motion. It will be again a partial map, and it will be defined as a composition of the toggles along a linear extension. And it's not hard to see that it's actually independent of the linear extension. It's because if you have two different linear extensions, you can transform one into the other by swapping adjacent elements that are incomparable. This is a pretty well-known fact. I think computer scientists use this all the time, but it's also in, several people have rediscovered it. It's pretty easy to prove. But the thing is, when you swap two elements, two toggles, TV and CW, when V and W are incomparable, those toggles commute. So the composition stays the same. So here is an example. Here is a 2x2 rectangle. And I'm drawing it, I'm drawing the P hat because I need those two labels at the bottom and the top. And here is a generic labeling, just a labeling by some arbitrary elements, which we don't assume anything about. As I said, the non-commutative birational row motion, which I call capital R, is the composition of the toggles. So So we start at the very top, and I will go around the order top, left, right, bottom. So starting at the top, you had a Z here. You multiplied, you inverted it, you multiplied it by the sum of the things below, which is X plus Y, and you multiplied it by the harmonic sum of the things above, which is B. That's because the harmonic sum of a single thing, of a single element, is always that element itself. Okay, next step, left. This is a bit more complicated because the thing above is now a bit more complicated, but still, not very difficult. Then we do the same thing on the right. It should be clear at this point that those toggles commute. And finally, we do the thing with the W. Well, this looks pretty complicated because you're taking the harmonic sum of this and this. However, miracle in a way, well, not so much of a miracle here, but it simplifies to A, Z inverse B. In hindsight, this is not surprising because you have a lot of like equal terms here, which you can take together. But generally, simplifying a rational expression like this with non-commuting elements, this is more art than science. There are methods to do it, I believe. I'm not fully sure, but these methods are pretty theoretical at this point. They are hidden in at the end of long textbooks. They are hidden in research papers. I don't believe anyone has implemented them on any computer algebra system. I would love to learn better, but unfortunately, this one is doable by hand. Okay, so the thing you see on the right is the image of the thing you see on the left under non-commutative birational row motion. And the labels at A and B, of course, have not changed because we are only toggling the vertices of P. We are not toggling at the new zero and the new one. The zero and the one are simply there in order to not get zeros here. They're basically guarding our elements. So what does this new non-commutative birational row motion have to do with the original order ideal row motion? Well, it generalizes it. So to see why, you have to be a little bit liberal with the definitions. So instead of taking K to be a ring, you take K to be a semi-ring, specifically the tropical semi-ring. This is actually a semi-field. And then for each order ideal, you can define a labeling over the tropical semi-ring by labeling a vertex with one if it's not in the order ideal, and labeling it zero if it is in the order ideal. This is injective, so each order ideal becomes a different labeling. And so you can treat order ideals as a particular case of labelings. And then it's not hard to see that our new toggles become our old toggles. And so our new row motion becomes our old row motion. And if you don't believe in semifields, you can use the rational numbers, but then you will have to take the so-called tropical limit. Anything you prove about non-commutative birational row motion, you therefore automatically get a corresponding result about classical row motion. Now, what can we prove about non-commutative birational row motion? When the ring is commutative, this has been studied for something like 7 years now. And there are some results. First, if the posit is a rectangle, then doing it p plus q times is the identity. This is basically the same order p plus q result that we had at the beginning for order ideals, but this is, of course, much more general. And in particular, for birational row motion, there is no reason why the order should be finite. So it's in a way a lot more surprising. So there is a bunch of other posits where the order is finite and simple. For a half square, it is 2p. For a top half, so triangles, it's again 2p. And furthermore, you have the same behavior where if you do it p times, you're just reflecting things around the vertical axis. This generalizes to minuscule posits for Lie algebras. And the order of this map will be the Coxeter number, proved recently by Soichi Okada. There is also a version, sorry, what happened? Okay, there is also a version for forests. You have to be careful. It's not any forest will work, only the forest where the leaves are all at the same depths. But in that case, the order will be something like this LCM. Actually, the order will be a divisor of this LCM. You can tell which one. In general, however, the order can be infinite. Here are two pretty simple posets for which the order is infinite in the birational setting. So there is some complication involved in going birational. And in particular, the proofs get more complicated. But things get even more complicated when the ring is not commutative. Here is a very simple poset with just four elements, the claw, so to speak. It's if case commutative, its order is just six. Because it's a forest with all leaves on the same level. But if K is not commutative, I don't know whether anything like this is true. If so, I haven't found it. So does anything work at all in the non-commutative setting? Well, let's try the rectangle again. It's one of the best behaved cases already. So it has the best chances. So I'm gonna fix two positive integers P and Q, a ring K, and this poset capital P, which is P cross Q. So this P by Q rectangle. Here is how it looks like for P equals 3 and Q equals 4. Let F be a labeling of this rectangle, and let A and B be the values at the very bottom and the very top. Then it turns out that there is something like the period P plus Q phenomenon, except it's a little bit twisted. The claim is if A and B are invertible and the P plus Q wise row motion of F is well defined, you have to assume this because you cannot rule out that the denominators will be non-invertible at some point. If at some point the map fails because something is not invertible, well, you have to, you can't do anything. But if things stay invertible, then after P plus Q iteration, motion, you will get back your original labels, except on the left, they're multiplied by AB inverse and B. I call this a twist. So back in 2015, doesn't this look like the inverse of this? Well, it's not because the order is wrong. But this is what comes out. So I call this periodicity theorem, even if it's something more like a spiral periodicity where nothing really comes back as it was, but it gets close. And there is another theorem which we call reciprocity theorem, which is, I will show an example that I think will clear it up somewhat. Basically it's saying that if you do, even when you do less than P plus Q iterations, some values get sort of repeated, but they don't literally get repeated. They get repeated as inverses. Specifically, a label at a point ij comes back as the inverse of a label at the antipodal point. And by antipodal, I mean, for example, 3,2 is antipodal to 1,3. So basically reflection around the center of the rectangle. Okay, so here is again an example. The example that we had, a labeling of the 2x2 rectangle. This is what comes out if you do it, if you do a single row motion. So RF, basically RF. This is what happens if you do R square F. So you row motor twice. This happens when you row motor three times. I'm no longer drawing the thing on the left because there is a symmetry. Whatever you have on the right, the thing on the left will be analogous. And here is the thing after four row motions. But wait, shouldn't that be the same as F up to this twist? Well, yes, but it's actually true because the thing simplifies a lot. After simplifying, you get this here. And this is periodicity. This is probably the simplest non-trivial case of periodicity. The labels W, X, Z, and Y are the labels you started with, except that they're now bordered by these A's and B's. So incidentally, a similar result did appear once in the literature in a paper. There was a periodicity conjecture of Koncevich proved by Yudo and Shkarin. It's far from the same, but it has a similar flavor. Other than that, I haven't seen that many results about this kind of non-commutative dynamics being periodic. I would love to hear more. Okay, so much for periodicity. Now, briefly, what is reciprocity? For reciprocity, let me draw the entire orbit, so to speak. So here is the original labeling. Here is it after one row motion, here after two, here after three. And I'm no longer drawing the A and B because the A and B never change. The toggles only change the labels of the elements of P, not at the zero and the one. And now I have color-coded elements that are sort of entangled by reciprocity. So for example, A Y inverse B is more or less reciprocal to Y. A Z bar B is more or less reciprocal to Z. So the idea here is this. After one row motion, the thing at the very bottom will be reciprocal to the original value at the very top. Except it's not, of course, it's not just reciprocal, it's A times the reciprocal times B. Okay, so basically it takes one row motion to get a familiar value at the bottom level. It takes two row motions to get familiar values at the middle level. And it takes three row motions to get a familiar value at the top level. And this is how reciprocity really works. So if your element, if you're looking at a label at level K, so this being level one, this being level two, and this being level K, the scientific notion for this is, I think, rank in the coset. So if you're looking at rank K, and you want to see familiar values, you have to do row motion k times. So one time to see them here, two times to see them here, and three times to see them here. And the value you will see there is the original value at the antipodal point. So here it will be the value at Z. Here it will be Y. Here it will be X. And here it will be W. Okay, and now that you know this pattern, of course you can apply this starting with R1F instead of R0F, and then you have more of these entangled things. So, for example, if you start at R1F and you do one row motion, you end up here, and so you're seeing a familiar value at the bottom. So basically, in this orbit, you have half as many values as you would expect, in a way. Okay, so before I come to sketching the proofs that we have now, let me say a quick couple words about how we proved the facts for commutative K back in 2014. So the thing is, Alexander Volkov back in 2006 proved something called the logic of periodicity for Y systems of type AA. And this, our result was in many ways similar. So our proof sort of imitates his argument. We start with the field because it doesn't matter much whether we are in a ring or a field. We show that, so basically we parameterize our labelings by certain matrices. The parameterization is not completely surjective, so not every labeling comes from a matrix, but almost every labeling comes from a matrix. So we have a dominant rational map, and the nice thing is when we apply row motion to our labeling, it's basically the same as shifting the matrix cyclically. So the last column gets moved to the front. But this shifting map, if you do it p plus q times, then of course you have the identity. So the same holds for row motion. I'm lying a little bit. It's not exactly shifting, but it's similar. So unfortunately, the devil here is in the details. And the detail, so if you're just looking at the idea, the parameterization can be extended to non-commutative k using what is known as non-commutative determinants or quasi-determinants. So the canonical sources on that are by Gelfand and Rietach. And there is a formula which, given a matrix, gives you a labeling. And if you want to row mode the labeling, you simply shift the columns of the matrix. Unfortunately, the little technical details break down. It's not clear how to... So if you have proved it for labelings that you obtain from matrices, it's not clear why it has to be true for all the other labelings. You cannot assume that K is a skew field. Rings are more complicated than skew fields. So I would, again, I would be interested in hearing, in learning better, but for now, we believe that this approach is a dead end. Okay, a couple quick words about another approach that we tried based on work by Greg Musiker and Tom Robbie in 2018, which reproved the commutative case using lattice paths. Specifically, they gave an explicit formula for RKF. So basically, they gave an explicit formula for all of those values, at least in the commutative case. The word explicit does a little bit of hard work here, but it's, for example, here is the value at 3,2 after three row motions. You see that the AIJs are explicit values. This is a certain sum, and this is another certain sum, so it's a fraction. And in general, the sums involve non-intersecting lattice paths. Well, lattice paths, you can work with lattice paths in the non-commutative case, but non-intersecting lattice paths are not clear how to do that, because you have to choose an order in which you multiply them, and the things don't commute, so it doesn't seem to work either. So we are back at square one. All the known theory basically breaks down, and all we can do is we just play around with the setting. So let's first introduce shorthands. P, Q, P, and F are fixed. We assume that all the necessary row motions are well defined, so no division by zero. We let A and B be the values that are unchanged, so the value at the very bottom and the value at the very top. And we write XL for the value at the point X after L row motions. So I'll refer to L as the time. We're thinking of is that we're having a dynamical system. Every second you're doing a single row motion. So XL is then the value at the element X at time L. So X0 is the original values. And furthermore, the values at the vertices 0 and 1 will always stay A and B. They never change. So this is a recursive way to define or to redefine our birational row motion. It's pretty easy to see that this is equivalent to our definition as a composition of toggles. Because how does the label at V change? Well, it gets inverted. It gets multiplied by the sum of the things below and by the harmonic sum of the things above. But by the time you're toggling V, the things above have already been toggled. So it's RF of U here, not F of U. Whereas the things below have not been toggled yet, so it's F of U. And this is just another way, this is just a rewriting of this formula using our new shorthand notations. So RF is V1 because it's time one, whereas F is time zero. So here is the formula just copy-pasted. And of course, whatever holds at time zero must also hold at time L because we're doing the same thing every second. So you get this equation, which tells you how to go from time L to time L plus one. Okay, so we haven't done anything serious yet. We just restated our definitions. And let's also restate our claims. Periodicity is saying that a value at time p plus q is this corresponding value at time zero, twisted. And reciprocity says that a value at a point x at time l is closely related to the value at the antipodal point y at time l minus I minus j plus 1. And the first step to simplifying the problem is to realize that periodicity actually follows by applying reciprocity twice, because the antipode of an antipode is just the original point. So we have one less thing to prove. We just need to prove reciprocity. Moreover, when you're proving reciprocity, you can assume that L is I plus J minus 1. So this time is 0 then. Because if you've proved something for time 0, our dynamical system is sort of time homogeneous. So basically, it's that you can apply to any later time. So here is a bunch of useful notations. A path, this will just mean a sequence of elements of our extended pose at p hat, that every time you just go one step down. For any element v of the poset and any time number l, delta vl shall mean, basically, this is saying VL divided by the sum of the labels below L. Except you have to specify, are you dividing on the right or on the left? Well, we choose right. Nabla VL is a little bit more complicated. Instead of below, you take above, and you take the harmonic sum, and you divide in the other direction. And at the point 0 and 1, you just set it to be 1. So thus we have defined this delta and nabla for a vertex, for a point V of the poset. Next, we define them for any path instead of a vertex, simply by saying you just multiply them for each for all the vertices on the path. And finally, if U and V are two vertices, so elements of P hat, then delta U arrow V is going to be the sum of the delta PLs over all paths from U to V. So you're taking those fractions, you're multiplying them over a path, and you're summing those products over all paths from a given vertex to a given vertex. Okay, what's the point? The point is that if you forget the original labels, so the VLs, the ULs, and blah, 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 you only remember the deltas, you can reconstruct the original values by these formulas. So you can reconstruct the ULs from the nablas using this formula, or from the deltas using this formula. And this is actually pretty easy to prove. I will omit the proof, but it's basically induction. So this formulas actually hold for any poset. Our rectangle is a little bit special in that we're adding a global maximum and a global minimum, but a rectangle already has a global maximum and a global minimum. Those are the points PQ and 1, 1. So if you have a path that starts at 1 and goes down, its first step has to go to PQ. So we can basically start it at PQ just as well. And so you get those two extra versions of A and B, where you, instead of starting the path at 1 and ending it at 0, you started at PQ and ended at 1, 1. So this is pretty clearly equivalent. So, okay, but the other interesting feature of deltas and nablas is that the nablas at time L plus 1 are the deltas at time L. And this is basically the definition of row motion rewritten. I call this the transition equation, partly because I think of finite state machine terminology, but it's also how you transit across time. So it's like the time travel component of the argument. And of course, because this holds at every vertex, this also holds for every path, and therefore this also holds for sums of paths. Now we can already make some progress. We can prove reciprocity for the bottommost element. Remember, the bottommost element Reciprocity in the, for the bottommost element is the simplest case of reciprocity because it you see an old value immediately after just one row motion. So it stands to reason that this is the simplest case. And indeed, what you do is you take the value at time one, you rewrite it using Nabla, then you turn Nabla into delta using the transition equation. And as you know, the transition equation moves you one step backward in time. And then again, you turn it back into a value at time zero now because you're at time zero. And this turns out to be exactly the topmost element. So reciprocity is proved at 1, 1. Well, okay, but that was in a way the easy part. How do we get further? There is a simplification which I have to skip because it's only 5 minutes. Basically, there is a symmetry built into the definition of row motion. And so if you look at an element M and like the things below, above and below, if you look at those 5 elements of your poset, if you have proved reciprocity for 4 of them, you can easily obtain reciprocity for the 5th, just basically by comparing the equations that are relevant and realizing that almost all parts are equal, so the remaining parts must also be equal. And this argument works even if ST and U do not exist. You need M and V only. So using this argument, you can do some sort of induction where if in order to prove reciprocity for V, it suffices to prove it for M, U, S, and T, which are like further left and down than V. Therefore, all that remains is to prove reciprocity for J equals 1. So basically prove reciprocity only for the vertices at the left, at the lower left edge of the rectangle. Okay, and we've proved it for the vertex 1, 1. Let's try 2, 1 now. So we need to show that the label at 2, 1 at time 2 is A times the inverse of the label at 0 at the antipode times B. We can use the path formulas to rewrite both of them in terms of deltas and nablas. And then using the transition equation, we can rewrite both of them in terms of time one. So the claim here boils down to this equation. And this is interesting in that it only involves time one. So this equation does not actually have to do with birational row motion anymore. We're comparing deltas and nablas at the same time. So it's coming from the same labeling. So we can get rid of the one subscript and we just have to prove this delta equals to this nabla. More generally, I call this the conversion lemma. It says that if U and U prime are two adjacent points on the top right boundary of the rectangle, and D and D prime are two adjacent points on the lower left boundary, then delta from U to D, so the sum over all lattice paths of the delta sum over all lattice paths that are like the red one equals to the nabla over the blue lattice path, so U prime to D prime. And by the way, this is not really more generally, just as you can derive this from the lemma, you can also derive the lemma from this. So at this point, we're not losing anything by going to this lemma. It turns out that this lemma is actually more useful than it looks. It doesn't just help us prove the 2-1 case, it actually proves all the cases on the lower left boundary. You just have to apply it many times. So you have to use the path formula, the transition equation, the conversion lemma, the transition equation again, the conversion lemma again, all the way until you go down to time zero. Every time, this is basically, it's a kind of dance move. Nabla becomes delta by the transition, but delta becomes nabla by the conversion lemma, and then you can do the same argument again and again. Okay, and this proves reciprocity in exactly those in those cases where we need it. So we need to prove the conversion lemma. Unfortunately, this is something I really have to skip. It's a nice argument using what we call pass jump pass. So it's not just pass, it's like it's almost a pass, but one of the steps is in fact a jump. And the argument is somewhat similar to the arguments you know from lattice models, the Young-Baxter-Zipper argument. So this is another interesting connection that remains to be explored. You can also restate it using matrices. Okay, so I have 1 minute, right? This completes the proof for the theorems that we stated. Which I think is even easier than the proof we had back in the commutative case 6 years ago. However, I still believe we are missing something. The thing is, our birational row motion does not involve subtraction. It's all addition, division, multiplication. So we don't need a ring to do it. We need a semi-ring. And actually, we used a semi-field to get classical row motion back. So this is not just some random generalization. This is a generalization of clear combinatorial significance. Nevertheless, our proof does not work for semi-rings. We have to use subtraction in our induction. And unfortunately, in the commutative case, you can simply hand wave the problem away. You can say if it's true for rings, then it's true for commutative semi-rings because the risky blah, blah, blah. It's just polynomial identities. You just multiply with the denominators, blah, blah, blah. In the non-commutative case, this does not work. I owe to David Speyer a beautiful example of an identity that is true for rings, but not for semi-rings. And by the way, in the notes, all the red links are clickable. So the question is, are our results still true for semi-rings? Another question is, as I already hinted at, what about other posters and rectangles? And finally, have you seen anything like our results, anything like this, any non-commutative dynamics being periodic? And with this said, I finish. I thank the organizers for inviting me, Tom, of course, for collaborating. And here is a bunch of references. Once again, they're in the slides.
Thank you very much, Darish. So thanks to speaker. So as I can't really see many people in the RCS in person, if there is a question, maybe somebody could let us know.
Yeah, it's Maxim Kantsevich. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, yes. I have a couple of questions and remark. First of all, you have your frozen. You have only two frozen variables, kind of zero and one.
A and B. Yes.
A and B. Yeah. Could you put more frozen variables just to put on the top and on the bottom? More kind of
upper. You mean like in the middle, so to speak. So
yeah.
I don't think there is any periodicity then. Even in the commutative case, we tried, we didn't get periodicity.
I see. Yes. Yeah. Second, do I understand this all your examples when you have this non-commutative periodicity are kind of planar diagrams in a sense? Yeah, the Hasse diagrams are.
Yes, they're much better than planar.
Yes. Yeah, because what I think it's what is going on. We have I don't know. Have you seen our recent paper with Sasha Goncharov? No.
About maybe
a month or two ago. It was posted on archive. Mm-hmm. It's about how to get this various in free non-commutative variables, this A and B in X coordinates and cluster structure, and the whole thing is labeled by. Kind of core, some collection of core-oriented lines on surface, usually on disk. Mm-hmm. And when one can make transformation one to another, one can go to some three-dimensional picture. And I think it's actually your notations are in your arguments. You do something like in three dimensions. That's my guess. Yes. And this is periodicity by the logic of, I think it's a very simple example for some special collection of coordinated lines around. It's kind of like Stokes diagrams for irregular singularities. And
I don't know that. So it's on the archive, right?
It's on archive, yeah.
Thank you. I'll take a look.
Yeah, and the last remark, it's about, you mentioned quasi-determinants at some point, and actually this is my conjecture about 3x3 matrices, which Natasha Yuda brought, was based on this kind of crazy question I asked myself many, many years ago. If you consider n by n matrix with coefficients in skew field, this quasi-determinants form again quasi n by n matrix. And then I try to repeat this operation. Then it's commuted. This left and right multiplication, and I check on computer, it's really
periodic. I see.
3x3. And the case for 4x4, it should be some non-periodic, but very, in a sense, integrable system. Should be E8 symmetries.
I see.
Yeah. Actually, I gave a talk in Moscow some years ago about with kind of various ideas about non-commutative birational identities. I can send you the link.
Thank you.
Okay. Awesome. Yeah, and also our stuff is Sasha Gonchev. Maybe can give some light on this semi-rings, because this skew field is again on some sort of generic point. We parameterize object in some category, and if you kind of add some kind of degenerate cases, it will be, you don't allow some. Maybe this categorical viewpoint, which you have on our paper, can help do this stuff.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
But this definitely should, this rectangles or squares, it will be half squares, will be part of the game. Okay, thank you.
Thank I put a link much. In the chat to which I think is the paper that Maxim was referring to.
I think we have one more. I have only one paper with Sasha Gonchev. So
okay.
Okay.
And I think we have time for one more question by Cyril. Cyril, are you able to ask it in person?
Oh, so Cyril's question. Even in the commutative case, we don't know how to really find out whether an order is finite. So, but we of course, if it's finite, you can check it by computer. If it's infinite, sometimes we prove that it's infinite using tropical Semmerings. But there is no guarantee that it will always work. So, it's more of an art than a science for now.
Thanks, speaker again.